Happy Thanksgiving from the 700 Club.
Give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
Hear the true story of the man who saved the pilgrims.
My name is Squanto. We mean you no harm.
Plus, get an up-close look at the Macy's Parade.
You get to work on some magic.
And see why it's so great to be thankful.
You probably shocked some people because it's so rare today.
On today's 700 Club.
Welcome to this special edition of the 700 Club. Nothing says Happy Thanksgiving quite like the Macy's Day Parade. And today we bring you an exclusive look behind the scenes of this iconic event. Plus, we'll meet the talented team who make all the magical floats and balloons. That's coming up later on this special edition of the 700 Club.
But first, we want to take you back in time as we bring to life the miraculous story of Squanto and Thanksgiving at Plymouth Rock. Take a look.
Thy help cometh from the Lord, who keepeth Israel. The Lord of Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. He shall become thy shade upon thy right hand. He shall protect thy incomings and outgoings.
In the winter of 1620, the pilgrims at Plymouth are struggling to survive. The long journey to America has taken a heavy toll on the weary travelers. They were not equipped to deal with the many challenges in the New World, and nearly half perished in the early days of their journey. In the midst of their struggle, they humbled themselves and turned their hearts to God, praying for His mercy and providence to protect them and establish their community.
Dear Lord, find us in the wilderness.
Their prayers would be answered through a series of divine and tragic events that occurred years earlier in the life of a young native boy named Squanto. It was the early 1600s in the area that would soon be called Massachusetts. Squanto and his tribe were curious about the white men from across the ocean who would visit their shoreline from time to time. When the ships arrived, Squanto and others went to investigate. During one of those visits, an English sailor, Thomas Hunt, not satisfied with his income and looking for dishonest gain, came to the region looking for opportunities. Hunt broke trust with the tribes and took Squanto and 23 other natives aboard his ship. The natives were forced into the ship's hull and taken across the ocean to Spain to be sold into slavery. Distrust for the white man grew into Squanto's heart during his travel across the sea, and he wondered why the Great Spirit would allow him to be so mistreated. Squanto did not know what his future would hold and wondered if he would ever see home again. Upon landing in Spain, the slave traders sold several natives. But Squanto was set free by a group of Spanish friars who disrupted the event before Squanto's sail. The friars took him in, and he lived among them. He learned how to speak Spanish and about their Christian faith, about the one true God of the Bible and his son Jesus. They taught him their self-sustaining lifestyle, planting and harvesting crops. Squanto grew to love and trust the monks, and life was good with them. But his desire to return home to his people, his tribe, never left him. He longed for the familiar places, the family and friends from whom he had been so violently taken. He prayed to God that somehow, someday, he would be able to return to his tribe. God heard his prayers. The friars devised a plan to get Squanto back to his homeland and to his beloved tribe. It would not be easy, and it would take several years, but their plan was put into action. He made his way to England, where he lived with and worked for an English businessman named John Slaney. Slaney and his Newfoundland company were looking for opportunities to expand trade with the New England natives. De Squantum had learned how to speak English fluently and would earn his way back to America, working for the company as a translator. Hope sprung up in De Squantum as he believed he would soon be home with his tribe. He remained in England for a few more years, but Tisquantum's hope never died. He'd been places that few in his tribe could even imagine, and he longed to tell them about all that he'd done and seen. Finally, in 1619, everything was in place. Once more, he sailed across the ocean. This time, his destination was home. With his feet finally back on familiar soil, De Squantum ran towards his village, excited to be reunited with his loved ones. His heart was crushed by what he discovered. Plague had ravaged his people only months earlier, and everyone had died. Of his tribe, only De Squantum remained. Confused and alone, he pondered his existence, his purpose. Why had he endured the years of struggle and false hope in strange lands? Why did he make it all the way home, only to find such devastation? Thoughts of death were not far from him. He was accepted into the neighboring Wampanoag tribe, but in his heart, he knew he did not belong. Word came to De Squantum that a group of European settlers had set up their camp on the very site of his former village. They were English, pilgrims. He spoke their language and knew their ways. He saw how they struggled to survive, how they prayed to Jesus for help, for hope. His heart went out to them, and he longed to help them. With the blessing of the Wampanoag chief, his Squantum made his presence known. The pilgrims were filled with fear at the sight of him. So far, relations with the native tribes had not been easy, and tensions were high. As De Squantum neared the entrance of the village, he raised his voice and spoke in perfect English.
Our name is De Squantum, and this is Big Bear. We mean you no harm.
The pilgrims were amazed at the sight and sound of him. They welcomed him in, and he made his home with them. In the spring, De Squantum taught the pilgrims what he had learned from his own tribe and his time with the friars in Spain, how to plant crops and fertilize seeds. He was their interpreter and helped make peace with the Wampanoag and other tribes in the area. Before long, he was more at home with the settlers than he was anywhere else. He lived with them and in many ways became one of them. In the fall of 1621, the harvest was abundant. The pilgrims were thriving. God had answered their fervent prayers through De Squantum, and in the process, healed his broken heart. In November of that year, the pilgrim leaders held a great feast, giving thanks to God for providing for their needs. William Bradford, the leader of the pilgrims, asked De Squantum to invite the Wampanoag tribe to the Thanksgiving celebration. They came and joined the party for 3 days, and there was peace and joy in the region.
Brothers and sisters, we gather today with thankfulness in our hearts. The Lord, in His mercy, has planted us and established us here. We have seen times of adversity and mourning and scarcity, but now the Lord shows us a time of harvest and plenty. And we are thankful for Squanto, who has joined us in our pilgrimage here to worship God freely. His path has not been easy, but the Lord was with him and sustained him and brought him to this place before us. And he has been an answer to our prayers here, that the Lord would provide for us, provide a way by his mighty hand. And the hand of God is with you and has never forsaken you. The psalmist tells us, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. And today, with our friends and our families and our neighbors, we will declare this a great day of thanksgiving, and we will celebrate, and we will praise the Lord for his mercy to us and his presence with us. Amen.
Without Tisquantum's help, the pilgrims may not have survived those early brutal years. Tisquantum put his faith in the God of the Bible and lived with the pilgrims until his death. He became known as Squanto, and his legend lives on today in the story of the first Thanksgiving, the Native American man whom God used to answer a desperate prayer from a desperate people.
I imagine many of you haven't seen that before. It certainly touches my heart to think that God Almighty, who knew a great land, a great nation was going to be risen in these shores, and he brought those people. Without that Indian, they would have died. They couldn't have survived the bitter cold, the winters, the starvation. But he showed them how to plant crops, and they had abundant harvest, and they were able to live at peace with the neighbors around them. God knew that, and to think it looked like it was like Joseph going to Egypt, the same thing. A young boy comes out. It looks like he's in chains. He's in the hardest of bondage, and out of that comes a hero who leads the nation. That's the way God works. Terry?
Providence. Amazing providence. Amazing. Well, up next, we promised you a peek behind the magic of the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, and coming up, you're going to get it. Meet the designers, the artists, and the craftsmen who make this the most celebrated parade in the world.
Well, this marks the 88th running of the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. 3.5 million people will line the streets of New York to see it firsthand, and another 50 million will watch it on television. But we're the only ones, get that, the only ones who get to see and hear from the team that makes it all happen. Just watch this.
Just 30 minutes outside of New York City sits a plain brick warehouse in upstate New Jersey that most people wouldn't even notice. But inside, skilled artists and craftsmen work in secrecy, creating masterpieces that millions will enjoy.
It takes a special person to work here.
John Piper is the studio director.
There's something that is bigger and grander than any of us who are involved in it.
I'm coming over!
That something is the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, the most celebrated parade in the world. It takes a gifted team of designers, carpenters, painters, welders, sculptors, seamstresses, and others to build and maintain every balloon, float, and costume.
Working on the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, you get to work on some magic.
But this is no child's play. Some of these pieces tower four stories high, and the work that starts the first of the year takes creativity, hard work, and long hours.
It's not just the skill set and the talent that you're looking for, it's the passion.
So you have to turn them the right way to make it look like, well, like animal hair, it always goes to shed water.
Carpenter John Chaney says this is his 39th parade. This year's creation is a rocking giraffe.
From Rope Works. So this is just regular rope, and you have to be a bit of a hairdresser to be a parade worker, I suppose.
Set designer Brett Garrity remembers catching the bug when he was a boy.
I saw my first parade in 1993. And immediately I was drawn to it. I just thought it was the coolest thing.
So at 15 years old, he wrote then studio director Manfred Bass a letter asking for a job. Until this interview, Brett didn't realize the studio had kept the letter.
Wow, yeah, that's pretty wild. And he told me, when you turn 16, give me a call and we'll see what we can do. So when I turned 16, I call him. They gave me a summer internship and I've been here ever since.
In addition to the floats and balloons, it takes thousands of volunteers to make the parade a success. And most of them are in costume. Kimberly Montgomery and her team are responsible for dressing all of them.
This is Macy's Costume Shop here in the Macy's Parade Studio. We're on the third floor, and we have about 5,000 costumes in this room.
That includes the most famous suit of all.
There's something special about Santa. You know, growing up in Missouri, I remember seeing him coming in, and it was the most exciting thing as a six-year-old to see Santa, and that was the real Santa. That wasn't Santa's helper. And now I know Santa personally. Like, he sends me birthday cards. It's really awesome.
With Santa's arrival comes the end of the parade. Costumes will be put away and the floats dismantled. Then a late-night turkey dinner will precede a long winter's nap. A well-deserved break after another successful kickoff to the holiday season.
As far as we can tell, we're the only ones been allowed to go back over, at least to inquire about how they do it. What a remarkable group of people. And to think that Macy's is a department store. That's all it is. It's a department store. Now it's grown, I think, nationwide, Macy's. But nevertheless, it's amazing how they do that. And I was asking Terry, how do you reckon they pay the bill? Because that's expensive. It is a fabulous thing. Millions of people enjoy it. It's been a part of America's Thanksgiving for decades. And we salute Macy's.
We surely do. Boy, right. Magical.
Magical.
Well, today is a specific day that we all set aside for the purpose of giving thanks. But thanks, or gratefulness, is something that we really should practice all year long. And guess what? Studies now show that an attitude of gratitude builds better relationships and even better health. Lori Johnson brings us this encouraging report.
For thousands of years, Scripture has been very clear: give thanks. And now health experts are saying the same thing.
Studies have shown that people with a more grateful disposition actually engage in more exercise. They eat healthier. They take care of themselves better by getting regular physical examinations. It's also been shown to be helpful with people who are having some kind of physical ailment, actually reduce negative health symptoms and increase sleep.
The research is clear. Grateful people handle adversity better, experience less PTSD, clinical depression, and anxiety.
Gratitude has been shown to actually help cope with stress and negative life events, which, of course, stress can be a major contributor to physical problems. Stress certainly tends to depress our immune system, makes us more vulnerable to disease, to sickness.
As a bonus, taking this extra step can help your family and friends.
Research is showing more and more that the quality of our relationships has a tremendous impact on the quality of our health. And gratitude actually has been shown to help improve the quality of one's relationship.
Most people aren't naturally grateful. That's why here at Revive Our Hearts Ministry, they actually teach people how to cultivate an attitude of gratitude.
Nancy Lee DeMoss leads the ministry, which includes a nationally broadcast radio program. She says gratitude starts with telling God, "You don't owe me anything good.
All I deserved was hell. And you've given me so much more than that. You've given me heaven and eternal life in Christ Jesus and your Holy Spirit. Oh, Lord, if you never gave me anything else good in this life, then having saved me eternally from sin, I am one blessed woman, and I will spend all of eternity giving you thanks."
Nancy says developing this spirit is like building muscle. It takes work.
Gratitude is, it's supposed to be a lifestyle. It's a habit. And unfortunately, it gets eclipsed by bad habits, the whining, the complaining, the murmuring, the pointing out things that we wish were different. But we can change that as we lift our eyes upward off of our circumstances and say, "Lord, you are amazing. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever."
In her book, Choosing Gratitude, Nancy recommends making Thanksgiving a priority for an entire month. Also, keep a journal, writing down all blessings, big and small.
And I found that that discipline helped me to be conscious of, mindful of, things that otherwise I might have forgotten, I might not have noticed. And I think that's why Psalm 103 says, "Forget not all his benefits."
And while you have your pen out, write thank you letters to people who've blessed you.
It can be emails, it can be texts, and I do it that way too. But I try to write some old-fashioned, longhand thank you notes to say, "I'm so grateful that you thought of me, for your kindness, for what you invested in me." And you know, you'll find that if you write that kind of note, you'll probably shock some people because it's so rare today.
And don't stop there. Express Thanksgiving out loud several times a day.
We're much better at saying, you know, what we wish we had, what we have that we wish we didn't have, rather than saying thank you to God and to others for what we do have.
So for better health, make a conscious effort to give thanks, a lot of it every day. It's not easy, but well worth the effort. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
You know, it would be easy to forget what Thanksgiving's all about and just make it a turkey day, but this really puts the focus where it needs to be. For more on the benefits of gratitude, we have web-exclusive expanded interviews with Nancy Lee DeMoss and Dr. Jennings. We encourage you to watch those at cbnnews.com. And for more tips on healthy living, we'd like to send you our free DVD. It's called Protect Your Health. It includes 5 segments with top-notch advice from experts. If you'd like to get your free copy, all you have to do is call the number you see on your screen right there, 1-800-759-0700. We want you to stay healthy and stress-free this holiday season. So call now, ask for your free Protect Your Health DVD. Up next, a chance to give our thanks to a decorated Marine who's been on 3 tours of the Middle East, completed over 400 missions, and saved countless lives. We want you to meet combat veteran Lucca when we come back. Military men and women deserve our ongoing thanks for their service to our country, and we especially remember those who are serving in combat zones this Thanksgiving and away from their families. Right now, you're about to meet a Marine who served in 400 missions, saving countless lives from IEDs.
IEDs, they're the number one killer of U.S. soldiers in the Middle East, and the best way to detect them is with dogs. This is Lucca and her handler, Chris Willingham. They served as one of many canine teams that detect explosives on the front lines. Lucca had completed over 400 missions and saved countless lives until one operation went terribly wrong. The new book, Top Dog, tells Lucca's inspiring story and how she has made a difference on and off the battlefield.
Please help me welcome to the 700 Club retired United States Marine Lucca and her owner, Marine Gunnery Sergeant Chris Willingham. Come on in. Great to have you with us today.
Thanks for having us.
Come on, sweetie. I suppose you don't like to hear her called sweetie.
No, hello. She's fine. She's retired now. So she enjoys it.
She's beautiful. Chris, so nice to have you with us. You have quite a history with this dog, and I want to talk to you a little bit about that. But how does a dog like Lucca become a military dog?
Well, first we'll test and evaluate the dogs to make sure they have the drive to be a working dog. Uh-huh. And once we evaluate them, we'll start a training cycle down at Lackland Air Force Base. And once they're certified, they'll be shipped out to the bases and become operational.
Wow. How long does it take to do that?
It's on average about a 100-day training cycle for your average basically trained military working dog.
Now, she is a pretty incredible dog, and you have formed an amazing bond with her. When did you first realize how special she was?
We were paired together April 23rd, 2006. And it was shortly after that. I mean, it was amazing to see kind of her personality, and you could tell she was always processing information and quicker than some other dogs I've trained. And so it was quick early on to see that she was a special dog.
Now she's part Shepherd and she's something else. I'd never heard of that before.
It's a great working dog. They don't have the hip dysplasia that the German Shepherds uh-huh. get. They have a great drive and just phenomenal when it comes to patrol work.
As I was reading your book, I've known that there are dogs used by the military, but you know, you don't have insight into how that works and why it's so amazing. But talk a little bit, if you will, about the value and the hard work these dogs bring and the security to those of you who are out there in danger's way.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. So in basically at the end of Vietnam, our primary job was more law enforcement oriented. Mm-hmm. After 9/11, just like everybody else, we quickly started adapting our tactics and procedures as to develop to what's going on in Iraq and Afghanistan. And we developed these off-leash detection dogs. That's what Lucca is. She's trained to search off-leash out in front of a patrol looking for IEDs.
You know? So she goes in front of you and the men
ma'am.
That are with you, men and women. And then how does that work when she's off-leash? How do you control that?
It's a lot of training hours put into it, a great bond. You know, it's a common saying that obedience is the foundation of all dog training, but also just as important as having that relationship with the dog, where the dog respects you, you respect the dog. And, with IEDs being the number one threat to coalition forces, these dogs served a great purpose over there. You know,
I guess
they were
so.
Between a well-trained handler and a dog, they were a great countermeasure to IEDs. Yeah.
Some of these dogs lose their lives because there's an IED that goes off while they're out in the middle of the field, and that's actually what happened to her, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. It doesn't happen as often as you think it would, mainly because, like I said, just between the training the handler receives on how to employ the dog.
They know what to look for.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
So how did she lose her leg?
So she was, I had her for about 5 years. We did two tours to Iraq, and then once I left Camp Pendleton, California, I handed her over to one of my younger Marines, Corporal Juan Rodriguez. I went on embassy duty, so I went to Helsinki, Finland in November 2011, and Rodriguez and my old platoon went back to Afghanistan. March 2012, they were leading a patrol. They just left a tree line. They were about 100 meters away from the tree line, and Lucca located an IED, and that was her second one with that patrol. And we start looking for secondaries once a dog responds. And so they're looking for secondaries, and the secondary IED was booby-trapped, and It took off her front left paw, and it caused pretty bad burns on her chest and upper torso. Rodriguez, is an immediate shock, but then his training kicked in. He does what Marines do, and he ran past the known IED and put a tourniquet on Lucca, picked her up, ran her back 100 meters to the tree line. They gave her a shot of morphine and had her medevac in 10 minutes.
Wow.
So it's 100. Rodriguez saved her life, and if you ask him about it, he'll just say he's returning the favor because
She's saved his life many times. Was that hard for you to let her go after you'd trained and become so bonded with her when you had to at that point?
It is, but it's it was coming and knew it was part of the process. I mean, we'd been together. We had a long 5 years together.
Yeah.
You kind of knew it was coming, and just to get a chance to choose the handler that's going to take over as Lucca's handler was a great opportunity, and Rodriguez was 100% the right choice. I mean, he did everything right during that patrol, and he had a great personality to match Lucca's, did a great job for me in Afghanistan in 2010, and I owe everything to him.
So how'd you get her back?
So that was when I handed the leash over to Rodriguez. You know, she was getting up in age, and it was going to be her third deployment, and so I was going to adopt her after that deployment anyway. The injuries kind of sped everything up. Because I said, just having 5 years with her, she was gonna come home and live with us. And it's a conversation Rodriguez and I had after the injury, and he said 100%, it's Lucca's your dog, and So they flew Lucca to Finland when I was over there working at the embassy to have to reunite us, and it was an amazing moment.
It was a happy day for both of you.
Absolutely.
I'm sure.
Yes, ma'am.
I am sure. Well, your book is so amazing because I think, you know, we hear in the news every day about the sacrifice that you all are making, fighting for freedom, and yet your book really goes into detail and helps us understand some of the day-to-day just grit and courage and strength that it takes to be where you are. So we thank you for the book. We thank you for your service. It's really an honor to have you here today.
Thank you very much.
She's quite the lady. Well, Lucca has a fascinating story. You can read all of it in the new book, Top Dog, The Story of Marine Hero Lucca. It's written by Maria Godavage, and I think you'll really enjoy it. It's available wherever books are sold. Chris, thank you so much for being with us today, for your service and for Lucca's service as well. Great to have you here. Well, right now, I want you to meet a former Marine and his wife. Roland Godet was struggling to meet the needs of his family after he retired from the Corps. But thanks to people like you, he and his family are now doing better than ever.
Once a Marine, always a Marine. And I know that I'm still a Marine wife, even though he's a veteran now.
Summer Godet knows the Semper Fi mentality will always be ingrained in her husband, Roland. He served 9 years in the Marine Corps, including a tour in Iraq, before landing a job in the civilian world. With two kids and one on the way, Roland works hard to provide for his family.
It makes me want to just continue to try to be a good husband and just continue to do anything I can to take care of her and my family, my girls, and my boy that's on the way.
Yeah. But finances got tight when the start date for Roland's new job repeatedly got delayed. They couldn't afford rent and were about to fall behind on their car payment.
I was pretty worried. I didn't know what to do.
The couple prayed that God would provide the finances to get them by until Roland started his job.
Every time something new comes in the mail with some red on it, I just pray that, you know, God, you'll make a way. I mean, I know what your word says, and I believe it.
The Godets' pastor, Roy Garza, told CBN about the family's needs, and CBN's Helping the Homefront wanted to help.
When we heard about this ministry that wanted to help military members, and they were ready to do it right away, we were just blown away. We were like, man, this is such an answer to our prayers.
Pastor Garza told the couple that CBN was going to help them get by until Roland started his job.
Together with CBN, we want to partner together to bless you with that.
CBN covered a car payment,
wow,
provided $1,000 in gift cards, and paid 3 months of rent.
Thank you so much. This is just reassurance of God using CBN, using your ministry, using our pastor to be willing to say, well, okay, let's partner up, let's do this.
To see, you know, a big organization that really wants to support the military and really wants to help, I think it's awesome.
Just a few months later, Roland got the call that he could start his job. He's now drawing a paycheck again, just in time to welcome the new addition to the family, Roland Godet IV.
I'm definitely grateful for CBN's Helping the Homefront, for everything that they've done. We wouldn't know where we would be without it.
God bless you.
God bless you.
With the sacrifice that these military men and women and their families make, it's great to know we can help them, isn't it? If you're a member of the 700 Club, we want you to know that you're a part of that, because Helping the Homefront is a CBN initiative. And if you're not at this time, we'd like to invite you to join us by joining the 700 Club. It's 65 cents a day, $20 a month. That makes you a 700 Club member, and you're joining with thousands of other people who are out to touch the world, to change lives, to bring hope. Or if you'd like to, when you give, you can make a special gift to Helping the Homefront. That's our outreach to military families. We want to let them know how much we appreciate their service and that we are here on the home front for them and for their families, especially when they return here. So to be part of that, give us a call, 1-800-759-0700, and designate your gift to Helping the Homefront. You can also mail your gift to us at Helping the Homefront, CBN Center, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23463, or you can log on to cbn.com and give that way. Pat?
What a wonderful story. Thank you, Terry. Well, up next, a man down on his luck makes a desperate decision.
I had given up by this point. I brought the propane inside the trailer with me. So I opened up the valves on them, and let the propane start flowing.
See how a Thanksgiving miracle saved this man's life. Well, you're watching a Thanksgiving Day special from CBN. This is the 700 Club Thanksgiving special. And we're thankful for all of you, and we're thankful that you're watching, and we hope this has been a glorious day for you and your family. Well, Rick Peters knows what it's like to be cold and hungry. So hungry that he actually sold his blood plasma to get food. And so hopeless that he actually tried to kill himself. But Rick's plan backfired on the day before he received a Thanksgiving miracle.
Yeah. Oh, how about a roll?
Thanksgiving Day is a time of traditions. For Rick Peters and his family, it's serving dinner at their church to the homeless and needy. Rick says, in a way, it's also a birthday celebration. His. Because on Thanksgiving Day, more than 20 years ago, Rick got a second chance at life.
Definitely a Thanksgiving miracle. I don't know where I would have been. Dead, probably.
If not dead, then surely locked up. His life of crime started in his teen years, after divorce and alcohol destroyed his family. He remembers the better times, like holidays and going to church to learn about God. But after the divorce, both parents ended up abusive alcoholics. His dad was prone to violence, while his mom hurled verbal insults.
My mom told me that I was the only mistake God made. To hear that, it was more than I could handle. I wanted nothing to do with church or with anything about God.
Or with his family. Rick left home. On the streets, he found a way to vent his anger and make a living.
Supplying the drugs was a very easy way to do it. Cocaine, meth, everybody wanted it. It was just a way of living. I mean, you have to do something to survive.
And for years, he did. He spent many nights in jail for dealing and using drugs, getting into fights and drinking.
I'd get out, and within just a few hours, I'd be arrested again.
Then he met Terry, someone who believed in him. They married and had a daughter. Rick wanted to change, but couldn't break the cycle. Still, she stayed.
Terry would just put up with it because she loved me.
After their daughter moved out on her own, Rick convinced Terry to move to the Arizona mountains to start a new life. He had bought a large stash of drugs, hoping to kickstart a business, but his plan fell through. Soon, they were out of money. They moved to a trailer in the mountains. They had no heat and could barely afford food.
We're eating very little. Maybe a half a meal a day. And we're coming into the early parts of winter, Thanksgiving time, and it was cold. It was real cold.
Desperate, they sold their plasma just for grocery money. Then Terry became anemic and couldn't give.
We finally hit a point of being at the very bottom. For me, I had given up by this point.
Cold, hungry, and desperate, Rick snapped.
I brought the propane inside the trailer with me. So I opened up the valves on them and let the propane start flowing. And I'm striking these matches and nothing's happening. And I yell out, God help me. I just wanted this to end. I felt like a total loser.
Finally, Rick gave up. He couldn't even kill himself. So the next day, they went into town looking for food. It was Thanksgiving, and they knew of a church that was serving free dinner.
Some gravy down there. Hello, ma'am.
As they ate, a man was sharing about God's love. Rick thought about what he said in the trailer the day before.
Maybe those words, God help me, had a little bit more impact than what I had realized.
The speaker sat down next to Rick and asked him if he wanted to pray and give his life to Jesus Christ. Rick said yes.
It was, Lord, come into my life and, Lord, rule my life. forgive me of my sins. From that moment, I felt the Lord come in, and I knew that it was real in me. There was such a wave that come over me of joy and of freedom. And the only way I can explain it is to say that I didn't want no more drugs. All these years of hiding this, all this anger that I had toward God, all of this anger was gone. There's no anger. And all I could feel was the love of God that was flooding into me.
Terry also gave her heart to Christ that day.
When we walked out, God started changing everything in our lives. I was given a whole new life. The day that I asked Christ to come into my heart, that day, Thanksgiving.
With God's help, they started putting their lives back together. Eventually, they reunited with their daughter and helped raise their grandkids. Rick is especially thankful that Terry didn't give up.
When you take into consideration that all the hell that I put her through for years, and here we are 30 years later, and the woman's still with me, and I love her dearly.
And now on Thanksgiving, they share God's love with others in need in the very church where they found new life in Christ.
Man, look at that. That's great.
God gave me back my life. And when he did that, he's never let go of me, and I'll never let go of him.
God gave me my life. Oh, can you believe that? That's what God does. You talk about miracles. We believe in miracles. We've seen healings, cancer and blindness and arthritis and all kinds of problems. But there's no greater miracle than the life that comes about from Jesus Christ. And Terry was gone. He was ready to die. His wife, Rick, and Terry, it was all over. But God gave them both a new life. Would you like a new life? Would you like this Thanksgiving day to have the greatest gift of all that you can be thankful for the rest of your life? If you do, I want you to pray with me. Wherever you are, just hold steady. It's Thanksgiving. Jesus Christ died for you. He lives. He lives. Bow your head and pray with me and pray these words. Jesus, that's right. Pray with me. Jesus, you know my life. You know the problems. You know the suffering. You know the confusion. But Lord, right now, I give it all to you. I lay it all at your feet. And I say, Lord, come into my heart. Live your life in me. And from this moment on, I'll serve you. And I'll be grateful and thank you that you died for me. Thank you, Lord, for hearing my prayer. Thank you, Lord, for a new life. Thank you. Well, if you prayed with me, I want to give you something. This is my Thanksgiving gift to you. It's called A New Day. And you just pray, just call and say, listen, I just prayed with that guy on TV. I prayed with Pat. I gave my heart to the Lord. And I'll give you this. It's got a CD in it, 73 minutes of very important teaching, and a little booklet. I'll give this to you free. But just call and say, listen, on this Thanksgiving, I gave my heart to Jesus Christ, and he gave me everlasting life. The number's on your screen. It's the toll-free number, 1-800-759-0700. Terry?
Well, when we come back, we're going to be praying for you and your needs, so stay with us. Back in a moment. As a working mom, Mary Woods has her hands full. So when she hurt herself right before Thanksgiving, Mary's life came to a standstill, but not for long. Watch this.
Okay, who wants orange juice and who wants milk?
Mary Woods is a super busy mom with two young daughters and a full-time job.
I get up in the morning, wake my girls up by 7:15, and get them moving and going to get ready to get out the door and not be late for school.
But her ability to keep the household running came to a standstill just days before Thanksgiving, when Mary injured her side while lifting a piece of furniture.
It was intense, almost if you could not get a full deep breath because the pain was so sharp. I went to the ER that evening and they told me that it was a pulled muscle and that there was not much I could do but allow it to heal. When I came home, within 2 days, I was worse.
Mary canceled her Thanksgiving plans and stayed on the couch to rest. That's when she prayed with the 700 Club and asked God for healing.
Pat spoke a word. There is somebody that has pain in their left side.
Something happened to somebody's stomach. I believe that I was going to say it was an ulcer, but it's not.
I just felt instantaneously that the Lord was touching me. A tear started coming down my eyes. I was able to breathe and move and bend without pain. The Lord had just instantaneously healed me.
Mary cooked her Thanksgiving meal pain-free.
I think that was probably one of the best Thanksgiving dinners I made because I was so happy to be moving and to be free of pain and to be able to actually make the meal that I wouldn't have been able to had the Lord not healed me. I am so incredibly grateful to God's mercies and grace for reaching out His hand and touching me.
If you're preparing a Thanksgiving meal, being out of capacity for the,
What a wonderful testimony. Well, we've got some prayer. We want to pray for people right now. And
here's a great testimony, Pat. It's a double whammy from Sue. Came to us by email. She says, recently I received a healing of my stomach and intestinal tract when Pat spoke a word that someone was being healed of an ulcer. During the same show, my husband received a call from the CBN Prayer Center asking if we needed prayer. He's unemployed and asked for prayer for our finances. Today, he was offered some work that will help to see us through. Our Father reminded us that He is with us in this very hard place. Thank you for all you do.
Praise God. Well, here's one more as we give thanks on Thanksgiving. Clifford of Taylorsville, Kentucky, he was having problems with a growth in one of his nostrils. After a while, he saw a doctor. They gave him allergy pills. Nothing really helped him. And then one day he was watching this program, and Terry, you had a word of knowledge, quote, somebody has polyps in the sinus cavity, you're being healed. Clifford said, I think she's talking about me, and guess what? Within 48 hours, Clifford's polyps were gone, and he was healed.
God knows your name.
All right, we want to pray together, folks. We want to pray. Terry and I are going to join hands. We're going to believe God for you on this Thanksgiving. Let's thank God. Father, I thank you. Jesus. I praise you. You said we bring our requests with thanksgiving to the Lord, and we come before you and make our petition known. There are people in this audience who are hurting. The families are being broken up. Children are they're running wild, and they need to come to the Lord. There are people who don't have enough money. There are people, God, who are desperately ill. There's some watching this program in hospitals. Wherever they are, Father, right now on this Thanksgiving day, let the anointing of the Holy Spirit come down in this audience. Touch them, we pray, by the power of God in the name of Jesus. Hey, a growth on the neck has just been healed right now. Put your hand on it. It was kind of popped up, and that just the growth will go down as I'm speaking. Terry?
Someone, you have a problem with bone disease in your mouth. You're potentially about to lose all of your teeth. God is healing that condition for you. The pain's going to go away. There's going to be a tightening of your teeth. Everything is going to work out according to God's perfect will for you.
Somebody's got some tremor. One of your hands is shaking, but it's not Parkinson's, but it's a tremor of some nature. But right now, God has just reached into your brain, and that tremor will cease in the name of Jesus from this moment on. Terry?
Someone else, a great fear has come upon you, and it just affects the way you see life, your relationships with people. Be set free now in Jesus' name. Rejoice in Him. Praise His name. That cloud is leaving you.
Inside your throat, there's some kind of a sore or, a growth in there that's bothering you. and you're having a hard time swallowing, just put your hand on your neck in the name of Jesus right now, and may this neck mm-hmm. and this inside of this throat be healed in Jesus' name. Touch.
And digestion problems. Some of you have it in your stomach, some in your intestines. You, God is healing many of you right now. Just lift your hands and praise Him as He sets you free.
It is Thanksgiving, and we just thank you for being with us to share this special Thanksgiving. Again, if you have a need for prayer, our counselors are there, Thanksgiving or not, they're there for you. And we leave you with today's Power Minute from 1 Chronicles, which says, both riches and honor come from you, and you reign over all. We thank you and praise your glorious name. Well, happy Thanksgiving for all of you. Tomorrow, a woman facing open-heart surgery is supernaturally healed. Took place in just 15 minutes. We'll tell you about that tomorrow, but have a wonderful day the rest of this Thanksgiving. And for Terry and all of us, this is Pat Robertson. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.